week we're exploring institutions and institutional reform in British North America. And we're in a great setting for that discussion. We're in a school built in 1866 in Waynefleet, Upper Canada, now in Ontario, of course. It's a really lovely building. And you get a good sense of a 19th century school. And I think what's interesting is that you might think this is kind of a quaint, old-fashioned school, but in our time period, this is actually a significant modernization. This is an expansion from an older model. Many schools prior to this were significantly smaller. And in fact, very few public schools or broad-based mass schools existed for anybody. What we're going to be looking at this week, though, is a kind of broader context for understanding that school. We're going to be looking at a series of institutions that are not so much being invented in the early 19th, mid-19th century, as being reformed, as the title suggests, and particularly expanded. And what we see in these institutions are some connections in terms of an approach to dealing with people. And there's a number of things we could point to here. The most obvious is that they are large institutions, larger institutions than they have been in the past. Prisons in the early 19th century were often just a building, just a kind of place where they would throw people, where they would keep them somehow locked up in some sort of fashion. They were small, they were completely unorganized in any kind of fashion. Same thing with schools. Schools tend to be very, very small. They tend to be private. They tended to be for very small groups of people, often two, three, four people, elite members of society, the children of elite members of society. We talked about this in our screencast where we looked at Bishop Strong and how he would educate the children of the elite. There are other schools in British North America being built at this time period, but they're, again, very small and very specialized usually. So, for example, a couple of indigenous schools, a couple of schools for poor people, but nothing really in an attempt to kind of reach out to other people. So the scale is really quite a significant change. The other thing we can point to is the way that these institutions are trying to deal with people. They're trying to use 20th century or 21st century language, they're trying to modify behaviors. And so prisons, asylums, schools are all ways to train people to behave properly in society. So what's really interesting about these things is that there's a kind of democratic impulse here to bring more services to more people, and particularly in terms of education, of offering opportunities and training for many more people, not just for the elite, but for everybody in British North American society, but also to train them and to discipline them, to get them to think in particular ways, to get them to think patriotically. We have a British flag here, but these are, remember, we're in British colonies, and they're meant to see the importance of British institutions, and we've seen this kind of anti-American stream in the course of the past. The Loyalists rejected Republican thinking, they rejected that American model. British North American schools are designed to inculcate notions of patriotic democracy and how the British Empire provides a sure form of liberty, a little more cautious form of liberty, one that understands better that sometimes hierarchy is necessary and that you can't eliminate all differences in society. Anybody looking at American history would know that they are not eliminating all differences in society, but they speak that language of egalitarianism and equality in a way that the British institutions didn't. So there's really that kind of notion of teaching a particular way of thinking. And I think there it's useful for us to think in terms of discipline as much as education. So they're certainly enabling people to go forward. They're certainly enabling them to learn new things, to go through life with the proper skills in education and numeracy and literacy and so on. But at the same time, thinking correctly about politics, thinking correctly about basic religious concerns. And that applies obviously to prisons as well. That applies to lunatic asylums. These are places where people are going because they have behavioral issues. And the notion is that the institution can be reformed in a way to help that individual fit back into society. And again, that same terminology can work really very nicely for prisoners as well. So children, prisoners, lunatics, different groups obviously, but at the same time sharing that expectation in a mass democratic society for behavior modification of a particular type. I'm done. I was actually wanting to talk about the desks, and maybe Julie and I can